This Firing Line special is produced by South Carolina Educational Television in association with the Southern Educational Communications Association and KUHT Houston. Funding for this program is made possible by major grants from American General Corporation, an insurance-based diversified financial company with more than $24 billion of assets. NCR, innovative computer technology. It can be expected from NCR. Oppenheimer Funds Management, the Oppenheimer family of mutual funds. PPG Industries, a world leader in glass, chemicals, instruments, and coatings technology. And additional support from these friends of Firing Line. The John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Mobil Corporation, and Essex Chemical. Firing Line salutes Houston and its brand new George R. Brown Convention Center. Lighting up the sky 4 weeks ago at its opening, the site for tonight's Firing Line special with the leading Republican presidential candidates. Houston also provided the site for Firing Line's similar Democratic debate on July 1st in its brand new Performing Arts Center. So hail to Houston for providing two new spectacular buildings to house the debates and the entrepreneurial spirit to make them happen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We have with us candidates for the Republican nomination for President of the United States. I'm the editor of National Review magazine and the host of Firing Line. I'm happy to advise you that one of the men you will be hearing here tonight will be sworn in as president a year or so from now. On the other hand, one of the men you will be hearing from tonight is my co-moderator, Mr. Robert Strauss, who is a Democrat. I'm sure you would all join me in deeming it a high gesture in the direction of national unity, positively Texan in its magnitude, if at the end of this program he would defect and join the Republican Party. We Republicans make way for late vocations. If that happens, Bob, we might nominate you for president.
Thank you.
Please join me in welcoming the candidates. As I've mentioned, we are all the guests of Houston, gathered at the George Brown Convention Center. I'm reminded by our hosts that Houston was considered as a possible site for the forthcoming Democratic Convention next summer, except that there were skeptics in the party who doubted that this convention center could be completed in that time. These are worry warts, the kind of people who sold out the kind of people who sold out of the stock market way back last summer. Yeah. We're here to get the flavor of six candidates, one of whom is the Vice President of the United States. We have much ground to travel, but there is no law during this period against anyone's enjoying himself, though my co-moderator, Mr. Strauss, is asked kindly not to laugh when we Republicans close our eyes and dream our dreams of balanced budgets. On the other hand, we will permit him to laugh if anyone suggests that any Democrat since Grover Cleveland showed us how to go about balancing the budget. But Bob Strauss is a gentleman of good humor and exemplary manners. He's unlikely to ask any of the candidates tonight whether they have ever been taken in adultery. or whether they have been guilty in any of their political statements of plagiarizing from the Constitution. We know, after the experience of Judge Bork, that is a capital crime. May I introduce my old friend, former chairman of the Democratic Party, Mr. Strauss.
Thank you, Bill. My first reaction is, that's one of the weakest introductions I've had in years. And second is to comment on those of you who saw it on television that your introduction of me of the during the Democratic debate was far more lavish, and I presume you're a bit embarrassed at my our friendship in front of your rich Republican friends that are in the audience looking at tonight. I would remind you that I have quite a constituency, even in this room here tonight, being in my home state of Texas. And I further not only will assure the candidates, but of probably more interest to you, I will assure you that I will ask no questions with respect to the kind that you referred to earlier. So with that, let me say this. Coming on this show, I had a bit of concern, Bill, as to whether or not I would appear too partisan. Your first couple of minutes here have led me to the conclusion I need not worry about that. I will conclude by saying we came here for a debate. Let's get on with it.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Scott. I forgot to say the greatest Texas Democrats in Sam Houston.
Thank you.
How's that?
That's better.
Yeah. When in July we met here with the Democratic candidates, we began by asking them the same question we will ask our guests tonight. It is the only segment of the evening in which they have been pre-advised on what is coming from the chair. As I said in July, every president on moving into the White House plays a little game of musical chairs, exiling one or two presidents from their presence on the walls and repatriating substitutes. President Reagan has hanging in his office the portraits of Jefferson, Lincoln, Taft, Coolidge, and Eisenhower. Beginning with Governor DuPont, whom will you remove, whom resurrect, giving us the reasons why, all in 1 minute?
Bill, I would hang the portraits of presidents of accomplishment, presidents of vision, presidents who sought to expand America's greatness with grand dreams. A president like Jefferson, who doubled the size of America. A president like Lincoln, who redressed America's sin. A president like Reagan, who strengthened America, who taught us something of our true values. But to tell you the truth, it's not so important whose portraits we hang as who's hanging the portraits. And all of my friends here, the Reverend, the Vice President, the Reverend, the Vice President, the General, the Senator, the Congressman, all think that their portraits ought to hang in the Oval Office someday. Well, so do I. But the question is, what plans do we offer? What visions do we have? Where would we lead America if one of us were to become the President of the United States? That's the question to be addressed by the six of us on this platform this evening.
Thank you, Governor. And we turn now to Vice President Bush. Mr. Bush.
Well, Bill, I'd leave Lincoln and Jefferson where they are now, right across from where the president sits there. Jefferson, Federalist, and Lincoln preserved the Union. I'd add Teddy Roosevelt on the wall to the left of where the president sits. Take charge kind of person, a great outdoorsman, I'd put in Ronald Reagan, from whom I've learned a great deal and with whom I've served side by side. And then instead of another portrait, I take the picture out of the Roosevelt Room, the Declaration of Independence. It's a completed picture except for three figures on the right-hand corner penciled in. And that would remind me every day to work to fulfill the total promise of the Declaration of Independence.
Thank you, Mr. President. General Haig.
Well, Bill, I'm not so sure that whose picture is hung really makes a great deal of difference. I've done a certain amount of that hanging and rehanging with seven presidencies. But I have been impressed as I travel around the country that many of the voters, especially mothers with children, have asked me whether or not a military man in the White House is not a danger to peace. It's interesting that there have been 12 generals who served as presidents. There have been 8 wars in the history of our republic, from 1812 to Vietnam. Not a single one of those generals led to the war. Not a one. And it's been my experience, only one who has seen combat in 2 wars, as I have, who's seen the sacrifice, the frustration, who's seen our young people shipped home in body bags, knows firsthand how critical it is to avoid conflict. Now, certainly I would put Eisenhower on the wall because of all post-World War II presidents, he used military power less than any. And besides, he never brutalized his Secretary of State.
Thank you, General Haig. Congressman Jack Kemp, Mr. Kemp.
Well, Bill, I would take down Taft and put up President Reagan. He recovered our pride. He rescued the economy from a period of high inflation and higher unemployment. He restored our foreign policy to one of respect, and he reminded us that there are no limits to what free men and free women can do when people are free to follow their dreams. But politics is not about the past, it's about the future. And this evening gives us a great opportunity to share with the American people our vision of moving the world away from a doctrine of relying on offensive nuclear weapons to relying on strategic defense. I see a vision of America fully employed, without inflation, for all people, from the ghetto and the barrio to the rural areas of America. And I believe we've got to defend the family and our children and our ability to raise our families in a period of prosperity and dignity and justice with those inalienable rights preserved for the future. And I'm looking forward to debating these issues tonight because I agree with Pete. This should be about the future, not about the past.
Thank you, Mr. Kemp. Senator Dole.
Thank you, Bill. Well, I've thought a lot about this, just as my colleagues have. And I would certainly want the portrait of George Washington, who made it possible for us to be here tonight. He made this country. I would take 2 portraits are now hanging in the Republican leader's office where I serve. One with Lincoln, the famous picture of Lincoln and his son Todd, who founded our party, abolished slavery, brought the Union together. Another is my boyhood hero, Dwight Eisenhower, fellow Kansan, born in Texas. Great American, great president. And I would hang a portrait of Harry Truman, a man who said the buck stops here, a man of uncommon common sense from the Midwest. And of course, Ronald Reagan, who has done so much for America, so much for all of us here. And finally, in a nice prominent place, I would have a picture of my parents. Maybe my father in his overalls, my mother, who meant so much to me and who made it possible for me to even have an opportunity to be here tonight with all these fine candidates and with all you good people.
Thank you, Senator. And Mr. Robertson.
Thanks, Bill. I would take down President Taft's picture. He's the father of the 16th Amendment and of the federal income tax. And in his place, I would put up a pledge that under my administration, we would balance the budget, but we'd do it by cutting waste and mismanagement in Washington rather than raising taxes on the American people. And the next thing I would do would put up the portrait of George Washington. I know there's one hanging in the Oval Office, but you can't have too many pictures of a great president. And I believe that for a man of integrity and a man of courage and leadership is what we need as we go into the next decade, into the next century. And besides, 200 years ago, we elected a Virginian as president of the United States, and maybe 200 years later, it's time to do it again. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob, do you want to make a comment on that before we move to the next segment or not?
It's up to you. It's your show. I'm just glad you're guessing.
Well, in that case, don't. All right. Well, we turn now to a brief autobiographical section. The producer went to each of these gentlemen and, pursuant to their own advice on how they wanted it done, came forward with 90 seconds, an intimate portrait of these gentlemen at work.
Hello, I'm Bob Dole.
And I'm Elizabeth Dole, and we appreciate the opportunity to visit with you tonight.
Right now, we're seated about 100 feet from the Senate chamber, where I've had the privilege to serve for about 19 years, and where I've been fighting for a stronger America, a fiscally responsible America, and a compassionate America. I've been serving in the Congress for over 27 years, 8 in the House and 19 in the Senate, and I voted in those 27 years about 10,500 times, and some were tough, tough votes. But believe me, if you're a leader, you have to make the tough calls. You know, I grew up in a small town, Russell, Kansas, where we cared about people, where we cared about each other, cared about our families, we cared about the government. I fought in World War II for those same traditional family values, and I would fight for the same if elected president. I believe the bottom line, when I travel across the country, is that the American people are looking for strong leadership, a hands-on president. I think I can do the job.
Bob and I have devoted our entire lives to public service. Now it's my privilege to tell Americans why I believe in Bob Dole. With strong leadership, America's potential is unlimited.
Hello, I'm Jack Kemp. As the parent of four children and a grandparent of two children, I realize that the most important influence on my own life looking back was my parents. My mother was a teacher and my father a small businessman. In the 1930s, during the Depression, they started a small trucking company to help put their four boys through college. I think essentially that's why I'm so optimistic about America and the American free enterprise system and the American family. I've had two careers, one as a professional football quarterback in the National Football League and the American Football League for 13 years, the last 8 years of which was with the Buffalo Bills. For 17 years, I've been in the Congress of the United States, representing Western New York, an area of our nation with manufacturing and farming, not unlike other parts of our country, with economic problems. I'm proud of the role that I played in the Republican Party, not only to broaden its base and to open it up to more people, but to help get America moving again without inflation. Proud of the Kemp-Roth tax rate reduction bill that was signed into law by President Reagan in 1981, and that helped lead to the tax reform of 1986, which by 1988 will leave 85% or so of the American families in a flat 15% rate. I'm not satisfied with the past. Politics is about the future. That's why I'm running for president, to defend peace through strength, the defense of the West, to defend our families and our children, and to help move this economy to full employment without inflation and equal opportunity for every man, woman, and child in this country.
Good evening. I'm Pete DuPont. I've been a state legislator, 6 years a member of the United States House of Representatives, and for 8 years I sat at this desk as governor of Delaware. When I came here, Delaware was not enjoying the best of times. Now we are. Working with thousands of people, we brought government spending under control. We cut taxes 30% for every working family. Jobs increased by 20%. Standards were raised for children and teachers in our schools. We succeeded because the people of our state demanded that some changes be made. Well, the people of America know there's some changes that have to be made in Washington, too. America was built on the work ethic, and yet our welfare system pays people for not working. Now, the Congress is tinkering with the welfare laws, but they're not going to require able-bodied people to work for their welfare checks. You and I know they should. On America's farms, our good intentions have turned into a costly mistake. Common sense would tell us there's a better way of helping farmers than spending $26 billion of our tax money to drive thousands of farmers into bankruptcy and raise food prices. Here's some other things Americans want to do as well. We want to drive drugs out of our children's classrooms and protect the retirement of our parents. We Americans are always restless to make progress, to solve problems, to try new initiatives, to expand horizons. Those are good characteristics in a people and in a campaign for the presidency.
Hello, this is Pat Robertson. You may have seen me on the 700 Club television show. What you may not realize is that I'm also in charge of a major United States cable network that has 37 million households in all 50 states. Plus, I was privileged to found a graduate-level university, 5 graduate schools, and a law school. But I want to take you back a little bit to some of the heritage, because my people got here around the time of the founding of the Jamestown Colony. One of them was a signer of the Declaration of Independence. 2 served as president of the United States. My father had a distinguished career, 34 years in the Congress, and included in that, he was chairman of the Senate Banking and Currency Committee. He gave me a very good education, Washington and Lee University, Yale Law School, and a business opportunity with W.R. Grace & Company for a while on Wall Street before I felt a call to the ministry and received a master's in divinity from New York Theological Seminary. But that's not all. One of the things that I'm proudest of is a very beautiful wife, 4 wonderful children, and 4 grandchildren. My wife is not only an assistant professor of nursing, but she's the principal United States delegate to the Inter-American Commission of Women. And Dee Dee, you've got some very serious concerns about what's happening with women and families in this country. Tell us about it.
Well, I'm very concerned about the plight of women, both in this country and throughout the hemisphere. But probably my main concern is about the single parent.
Ladies and gentlemen, we look forward to the debates. I've just finished a big victory in the straw ballots in Iowa, and I'm looking forward to this program.
Hello, I'm Al Haig, and this is my wife, Pat, who's been at my side for the last 37 years. I've been asked why I want to be president. The answer is simple. I've served 7 presidents in my lifetime. I know the job, its challenges, its rewards, and also the limitations on its power. 1988 will be perhaps the most important choice made by the American people in modern times. We are going to need a candidate of unusual qualifications. I've been an executive in the military, in government at highest levels, in the private sector with large and small businesses. I've been an educator in one of our greatest universities. And perhaps most importantly in this shrinking world, I've lived abroad. I know the concerns, the strengths and weaknesses of those who share our values and the wiles of those who do not. Therefore, I hope you will look at my candidacy as one which brings qualifications that no other candidate will bring. Experience, leadership, understanding required for the post-Reagan era.
Hello, I'm George Bush. For 7 years, I've been vice president, And now I'm a candidate for President of the United States. It may come as no big surprise to you, but let me tell you why I'm running. And first, let me introduce some of our family. This is George, our oldest son, one of our five kids, and Barbara, my wife for 42 years, and two of our daughter-in-law, two of our grandchildren. I'm running because I believe it is absolutely essential to carry on the good work that we've accomplished during the last 7 years. We've had a spectacular economic recovery. Taxes are down, inflation rates are down, unemployment is down. In the last year, more Americans at work than at any time in the history of this country. And that's all very important. But the issue that is overwhelming, as far as I'm concerned, is peace. That is what will motivate my presidency, keeping the peace. You probably get sick and tired of hearing candidates talk about their past records, but so let me make mine brief. I was a combat pilot, I was in business, I was a congressman, I was ambassador to the United Nations, chairman of the Republican National Committee, I was ambassador to China, and I ran the intelligence community, the CIA, for a year. I must have done some things pretty well in this job because they kept giving me new ones. And I was also a husband and a father. And how'd I do at that one, gang?
Great.
Great.
I just want to ask you to listen to what I have to say as I spell out my goals for the future. And I hope you'll make the decision to support me for President of the United States. Thank you very much.
You want to ask me to comment?
I will.
The next segment comprises questions, one each directed to each of the candidates, to which they will give an answer not longer than 1.5 minutes. Oh, I should say at this point that in July, dealing with the Democrats, we were forced to eliminate an entire segment planned for the evening and for your edification because the candidates exceeded their time limits. To prevent this happening, we have a supreme timekeeper. He sits with a console in front of him that permits him not only to ring a bell, but if necessary, to douse all the lights in the auditorium, and if absolutely necessary, to eject the delinquent by missile, landing him by parachute in Des Moines, Iowa, where they deal unkindly with overtime. In any event, we beg your cooperation with the timekeeper. Let me introduce Mr. Jack Raines, Secretary of State of Texas. The first question will be asked by Mr. Strauss, directed to Vice President Bush. Bob.
Mr. Vice President, you've just finished 7 years as a loyal Vice President. And I, like you, have seen quite a number of vice presidents. And I think that you're to be commended for that loyalty and support of your president.
Wait for the zinger.
We're not going to quit there, Mr. Vice President.
Thank you very much.
But now you are no longer just a vice president. Now you're a candidate for the presidency. And obviously, you have a responsibility to demonstrate your own independence, your individuality. And in that regard, could you tell us, in retrospect, with the benefit of hindsight, and without being critical of the president with whom you serve, several areas where you think the administration should have done things differently, or would have done things differently had you been president? And I hope the others who will follow you will address this same subject, since they, too, have either been a part of or close to the administration?
The answer is I could, but I won't. What I'll tell you is I'm not going to start, Bob, doing now that which I haven't done for 6.5, 7 years. We're here to beat Democrats, beat up on those six people that appeared here not long ago. And I'm not going to go down and fine-tune differences with President Reagan. I've resisted it, and you know, and I know, I've taken quite a few shots for conducting myself that way. But as I said to your friend Sam Donaldson a few years ago, in our family, loyalty is a strength, not a character flaw. So, having said that, I started in Houston when I said I'm a candidate, and I said, here's what we've done, here's the unfulfilled agenda, and here are my priorities. Education is one of them. Following on what I think is going to be a good INF agreement with a chemical treaty is another. I'm talking about a North American accord to include Mexico as well as Canada in free trade. I've talked about education savings bonds. I've talked about reducing the capital gains rate to add $5 billion worth of income for the federal government when it needs it, as well as creating more jobs. And these things I've just clicked off are not priorities with our administration. We've got other things that we've accomplished. So this is the way I'll handle it. These are where you might say there's a difference, but I think it's just taking something we've done and building on it, not going back and retroactively trying to distance myself from the president.
General Haig, would you comment on that?
Well, I would, and I admire everything that George just said. But I would also suggest that when one is parsing out loyalty, that to me, loyalty has always been having the courage to tell the man you work for what your conscience tells you he must hear, not what you think he wants to hear. And that's been my approach to every president I've served. And I think it's very important for us to recognize that there have been mistakes made. As strongly as I support President Reagan, and I've campaigned for him in two campaigns and served in his cabinet, we have some serious questions to answer today to the American people. The question of our deficit, the question of our relationships with the Soviet Union, while we are pummeling towards an arms control agreement, while Soviet forces continue to abuse freedom in Afghanistan. That's a question that has to be answered.
Thank you, General. Mr. Kemp.
One of the reasons I wanted to put up the picture of Ronald Reagan in the cabinet room, Bill, was because I am absolutely convinced that his willingness to challenge the establishment and buck the establishment was part of his reason for success. And as someone who campaigned for him in 1980, not against him in 1980, I think loyalty does not require blind loyalty. One of the biggest mistakes this administration has made, it seems to me, is buying on to a budget package in 1982 that included the biggest tax increase in this country's history, when the Congress had pledged $3 of spending cuts for every $1 of tax increase. The Congress didn't deliver. I hope we don't make that same mistake now. Another mistake is to fail to deploy and announce an early deployment of strategic defense. Those two things, in my mind, make for mistakes, and they can be corrected in the future.
Senator Dole.
Well, this has been a tough week, this last week, for the president, Mrs. Reagan, so I'm going to talk about the future. You know, I support the president on the Senate floor. I support him with action, getting the programs through, whether it's the 81 tax cut, whether it's a farm bill, whether it's saving Social Security in 1983. So there are a lot of good things we've done, but we've got to be honest with each other. A lot of things we ought to focus on. Our party has a problem with sensitivity. We're perceived as not caring about people, real people. The poor, black, Hispanic, white, disabled, we're going to correct that. And we're going to do a lot of other things in a Dole administration.
Thank you, Senator. Ms. Robertson?
Well, I'm, as these gentlemen, a great supporter of President Reagan. I think he's one of the finest presidents we've ever had in the United States of America. And having said that, we must recognize that he's laid a foundation. We build on the foundation. The foundation has got to be built up in relation to what does the future hold for our children. In the city of Houston, as beautiful as it is and as beautiful as this convention center is, there's 600,000 people who can't read and write. They're functionally illiterate. The number in America is 29 million. We're losing our competitive edge in terms of exports. We have an enormous budget deficit. These things are not necessarily the result of the administration. There are many of them a result of Congress or other problems. But we have to face these problems to ensure that our children have the kind of freedom and future we all want for them.
Governor DuPont.
Bill, there's one problem that not only has this administration not addressed, but none of my competitors for the presidency will address, and that is the solvency of a retirement system called Social Security for a whole bunch of people in America called baby boomers. Social Security works today. It's right, it's just, but it's not going to work tomorrow when that huge generation retires. And then we're going to have to either double taxes on our kids, or we're going to have to cut in half benefits for the baby boom generation, and neither one of those is an acceptable alternative. We need an alternative way of saving for our future, a financial security account that's privately invested, that we can control, that we can watch grow, that'll give us a retirement income much bigger than Social Security ever will. And while we're at it, we can guarantee the Social Security checks of all those people who want to be in the system. That's a problem that lies in the future that needs to be addressed by the next president of the United States.
Thank you, Governor. I have a question now for Senator Dole. The Republican platform of 1984 reads in part, quotes, that the unborn child has a fundamental individual right to life which cannot be infringed. We therefore reaffirm our support for a human life amendment to the Constitution, and we endorse legislation to make clear that the 14th Amendment's protections apply to unborn children. As Majority Leader, and then as Minority Leader, what steps have you taken to forward this position of the party, or do you dissent from it?
Well, I've made my own position very clear. I support a human life amendment. I've been supporting a pro-life position since 1975, 2 years after Roe versus Wade. I do not agree with Roe versus Wade. We've had a number of occasions in the United States Senate where we've adopted the so-called Hyde language, which is no federal funds for that purpose. And so we've made the effort. We've been supporting of the president, co-sponsored the so-called Hatch Amendment. And so we have a record of care for the unborn, which in my view is the right way to go. But having said that, I think as I started to say in my last response, we've got other concerns too. That's a very important one. Human life is certainly the most important concern. But I would say as a Republican Party that we need to reach out to people who may want to become Republicans, may not have had the opportunity, may never have been asked. And I think it's almost unlimited possibilities for us. What America wants is leadership, someone who can work with the Congress, someone who can get things done. And I'm willing to take on that responsibility.
Mr. Robertson.
True genetic problem in the United States of a magnitude beyond what we can conceive of. Pete mentioned it, the fact that by the year 2020, we're going to be running out of workers. There won't be enough to support the retirees. And as a matter of fact, by the year 2000, we will have aborted 40 million children in this country. Their work product by the year 2020 will amount to $1.4 trillion. The taxes from them would amount to $330 billion, and they could ensure the fiscal stability of the Social Security system, which is going to be near bankrupt by the year 2015. We've got to do something about it. And of course, I personally favor a paramount human life amendment, but I've said something else as president. I would guarantee a veto of any appropriations measure which included one dime of funding for Planned Parenthood.
Governor DuPont.
Well, Bill, the Constitution of the United States is very clear. that a question of abortion belongs in the legislatures of the 50 states, not at the federal level. And so we ought to overturn Roe v. Wade. We ought to overturn Roe v. Wade and send that question back to the people where it belongs. But you know, that is just one item on the social agenda of this country. Another one I'd like to spend a moment talking about is the problem of drugs in our schools, and I know that concerns a lot of mothers and dads in America. You know, I think it's time that we started testing teenagers in our schools and telling them that if they want a driver's license, which is a privilege in this country, that they need to pass a drug test and a driver's test. That'd get drugs out of our classrooms.
Mr. Vice President.
You know, I oppose abortion. I support an amendment. I oppose federal funding for abortion. I favor family planning information that has nothing to do with abortion. I look at the birth rates around some of the world here, and I think when countries ask for support and information on that, they ought to have it. But I do oppose abortion. And while we're at it, I want to be the education president. That's what I want to be remembered for on the domestic side. I think the best answer to many of the problems we're beginning to talk about here is an educated America.
Thank you. General Haig.
I, too, oppose abortion as a matter of right reason and faith. And I am opposed to federal funds for abortion. On the other hand, I think it's important, Pete, as we talk about our youngsters and drugs, that we recognize that we've yet to take this problem to its source. And that's those countries that are permitting, willingly or unwillingly, the production of those illicit goods within their territory. $40 billion a year are spent at federal, state, and local government level, and we simply haven't begun to scratch the surface.
Thank you, General. Mr. Kemp.
This issue really goes to the heart of what kind of a country we're going to be in the future. Thomas Jefferson said, 200 years ago, that the God who gave us life gave us freedom at the same time. There's a consensus in America about constitutional protection of freedom. There is not yet a consensus about human life. And I think in the next administration, we need a leader, we need a president who restores not only the respect for human life of the born and the unborn, but defends it by putting it in the Constitution through the Human Life Amendment, and then pledges to the American people that he would appoint men and women to the Supreme Court of the United States of America who believe in Judeo-Christian ethics and who believe in the inalienable right to life.
Thank you. Bob, it's your question.
Mr. Congressman, I have a question for you.
All right.
This week, members of the administration and a bipartisan leadership group, as you know, bipartisan leadership group from Congress, are meeting and trying to tackle a serious and pressing question of how we fix or do something about the horrendous budgetary and trade deficits we face and other related issues in light of the stock market debacle. What I would ask of you is this, as well as your colleagues. If you were president, what leadership would you offer this group as they go about their duties? Now, I realize you can't lay out a full program in the short time allotted you, but I would appreciate some specificity with your answer as well as that of your colleagues.
Well, Bob, first of all, you'd have to recognize that every stock market in the world crashing on the same weekend or the same day and going down exactly the same amount did not or was not the result of the budget deficit in the United States of America, as big as it is. Of course, we've got to get it down. But I've been warning this administration and warning through my speeches in the last 7 years and as recently as last December that unless we fixed the lack of a financial system for this world and a world trading system where there's stability of currencies and where the interest rates are low and in which growth and prosperity are growing, this country cannot possibly meet its obligations to either the budget deficit or the trade deficit. I would present to the American people and have a comprehensive program to put a lid on spending, provide the president with a line item veto, not raise taxes, but cut the capital gains tax rate. If we have to touch taxes, let's cut the capital gains rate. Let's put more incentive and more oxygen into the investment economy. Let's break down the barriers to international trade. Negotiate a free trade zone with Canada, Mexico, and then tell the Japanese and Asians and Europe that if they want to and want to trade in our markets, that they too have to reduce their deficits and reduce their barriers. Finally, I am convinced that this president ought to veto any tax bill coming out of this Congress. And unlike my good friend Bob Dole and even the vice president, I don't believe there's any type of a budget deal that you can make with Jim Wright that's going to be to the advantage of bringing down interest rates and deficits.
Senator Dole.
Well, we've got to deal with the deficit. We're not going to grow out of it, as Jack used to say, just cut taxes and don't worry about it. So we have to deal with it. We've got to be statesmen. We've got to be not Republicans and Democrats, but there's a lot at stake here. We had a meeting this morning. I was there with Republican and Democratic leaders trying to do that. We've got to insist, though, that if we tackle the deficit with budget reduction, that Japan and Germany stimulate their economies dollar for dollar with every dollar we cut, that they stimulate or reflate their economies. That's number one. There ought to be a World Economic Summit. It ought to be very quick. The president must exert the leadership. But we've got to get this done. I don't think we understand the urgency of the problem, and we better get with it.
Mr. Robertson.
Well, Bill, we're at the end of a long-range cycle, a 56 or 7-year cycle of debt. We owe $20 trillion as a world right now, and it's an insupportable burden, and that's why the markets are so skittish. Three things we can't do. We can't raise taxes, we can't raise tariffs, and we certainly can't raise interest rates. Even a 0.5% interest rate caused some of the panic, and thought that we would let the dollar decline, sent the market into a 509-point tailspin. We've got to get this federal budget under control. Congress has got to work with our president and stop temporizing and playing games with special interest groups. We've got to serve the whole American people.
Thank you, Robertson. Governor DuPont.
With respect to my friend Bob Dole, putting off curing the United States budget deficit until they do something in Japan is just plain nonsense.
Oh, I didn't say that. I said
the next president of the United States ought to say he's going to veto a tax bill. He's going to veto any protectionist bill that's got a whiff of Gephardt in it, that he is going to cut farm subsidies and save $26 billion a year in the short term, that he's going to replace welfare with work and cut about $7 billion out of our budget in the medium term, and shore up Social Security before a doubling of Social Security taxes destroys any opportunities for young people in this country. That's the kind of leadership we need to solve the economic problems of this country.
Mr. Vice President.
Well, I noticed an interesting article in the Times, New York Times today, saying economists, conservative economists and Keynesian economists think it would be foolish to raise taxes. As president, I will not raise taxes. Having said that, I think it is right to do what Bob's engaged in and what the president and I were in the meeting that we talked with the leaders about, to try to address ourselves to this problem. It's not going to go away. And we sent a budget up there, Bob, that had, what, $23 billion worth of varying kinds of revenues. That's a lot to work with. Doesn't touch tax rates or anything of that nature. But to sit here and suggest that it's not important, I'm sorry, I think it is very important. And I think it's a time to lay partisan politics aside, get it solved, and then, as president, not raise taxes.
Right.
General Haig.
I think it was some comedian who said a week ago we watched blue chips become cow chips. And indeed they did. This is first and foremost a crisis of confidence. And the centerpiece of that crisis is this mindless deficit. And I haven't heard any of my colleagues discuss how we got that mindless deficit. But today, we must remember what happened in 29. The Hoover administration first raised taxes, secondly, closed our borders to foreign trade, and thirdly, boosted interest. That transformed a financial crisis into a pervasive, long-lasting depression, and it's time for our public officials to speak out if they're in positions of authority along these lines.
Thank you, General. And as it happens, General, the next question is directed to you.
I'm delighted.
You are greatly experienced in government at every level, but unique in your military background. You have said that the projected agreement with the Soviet Union, which would remove intermediate nuclear missiles from the European theater, will weaken the Western alliance. How is it that military figures serving under the president are assumed to endorse the INF treaty? Is that protocol or discipline that prevents them from speaking out their true thoughts on the question?
Well, both. And of course, we have a tendency to pick our military leaders from time to time because of their flexibility. But let me counter what you said, Bill, because every NATO commander, including the current one, has spoken out against this INF 00 agreement. There are three problems with this agreement. The first is that it's going to place a greater burden on our already flawed imbalance in heavy central strategic systems, those in Russia and those in the United States. And we should have corrected that long before now. Secondly, it makes conventional war in Europe once again conceivable. And I've spoken to almost every head of state in Europe. And believe me, they are very unnerved by this deal. Thirdly, it ignores the fact that the Soviet Union is continuing to conduct aggression around the world, and that we have delinked, so to speak, their international behavior from arms control in a quest for arms control's sake. Now, I think it's time we played the Russian game and said, of course, we'll go on with this. But we have a set of conditions of our own. First, major reductions in central strategic systems, about 50%. Secondly, an agreement at long last to achieve some balances in the conventional area in Western Europe. Or we could be taking a major step towards World War III.
Thank you, General. Mr. Kemp, would you comment on that?
Bill, I wouldn't sign a new agreement with the Soviet Union until they're required to keep the previous agreements that they've signed with the United States of America. I can't understand why we're rushing into an agreement that threatens to denuclearize Europe. And I think it was Churchill who said that it was the nuclear deterrent that prevented the Soviet Union army after World War II from marching from the banks of the Vistula into Paris. The nuclear deterrent should be defended. We ought to move away from relying on offensive weapons to the reliance on defensive weapons. And I hope this summit conference with General Secretary Gorbachev gives us the opportunity to renegotiate a general reduction of arms across the board, including conventional, and move this country towards the defense of the American people from ballistic missiles.
Thank you. Senator? Senator Dole.
Well, I'm a little puzzled by Mr. Gorbachev. I mean, one week he wants to play, the next week he doesn't want to play, now he wants to play again. So I think we need a little dose of healthy skepticism. I don't think we ought to be out here cheerleading for any treaties until we know precisely what's in it. And again, I'm the Republican leader in the Senate. We're going to have to ratify that treaty in the Senate. I want to read it. I don't know what's in it. I think we ought to have that right, and we ought to know, and I don't disagree with Jack Kemp. We know of at least three violations that we can prove that Soviets in recent treaties, whether it's chemical or whether it's the radar, whatever it may be. So let's be very, very careful. I don't think Ronald Reagan is going to make a dumb deal. But as a member of the Senate and Republican leader, I want to make certain we can verify it and do something if the Soviets violate it. Time's up.
Thank you, Senator. Yeah. Mr. Robertson.
I favor the concept of linkage in our deals with the Soviet Union. If they really want peace, if they're really sincere, let them prove it. Let them get out of Afghanistan. Let them take down the Berlin Wall. Let the prisoners out of the Gulag. Let the Jewish refuseniks get out to go to Israel. Let them keep the other treaties that they have made with us. And when they do that, then we'll know they mean business. Until then, we see the deployment of the SS-24, a mobile MX-style missile. We see this psychological warfare against our president last week. I don't think they really want peace. They want their own advantage, and they perceive this INF treaty as their advantage, and I think it's badly flawed.
Thank you, Congressman. Governor DuPont.
Well, I cannot support a treaty that we may not be able to verify made with a nation we cannot trust. My friend George Bush says we ought to be for that INF treaty before it's even written. I believe we ought to read agreements before we even think about signing them. And I would hope my friend Bob Dole, when that treaty gets to the Senate, would attach a protocol to it that says it's inoperative unless there's an agreement reached to reduce conventional forces in Europe. Reduce Soviet conventional forces so there's a balance. Put together an agreement so when we see Pershings being taken home on our television screens in the evening, that CBS also shows us Russian missiles being taken home to be dismantled. But read before you sign, George.
Mr. Vice President.
I'm just back from Europe. And I talked to Margaret Thatcher and to Helmut Kohl and to François Mitterrand and Chirac and Giorgio and Martins and all the NATO Council, and they all support the agreement. Of course they want to read the treaty. I like an agreement that takes out 1,600 Soviet warheads for 400 of ours. I believe it will be verifiable. I believe our country wants it. I know Europe wants it. Jack Kemp, the day after the president made this proposal on November 18th, said this was a major breakthrough for peace, and this was what it was back then. We have stayed firm with the Soviets. We said either we'll deploy to equal numbers or you get rid of them all. And now we're getting rid of them, and this is the first time in the nuclear age that we are getting rid of an entire generation of nuclear weapons, and that's good for my grandchildren and the rest of the world.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. Mr. Strauss.
Thank you, Bill. Mr. Robertson. Mr. Robertson, many good Republican friends of mine are somewhat surprised at the fact that your campaign is having more of an impact than they ever thought it would have. Mm-hmm. But we're not going to quit there either.
All right.
However, they express concern, a number of them do, that one possible result of your candidacy is that it might move the Republican Party further to the right, out of the mainstream of American politics. Do you agree or do you disagree? And in either event, do you think that increasing the focus on issues such as abortion and school prayer divert the debate away from the critical economic problems that face this country?
Bob, I've just come from a swing in Florida. 50 to 60% of my audience have been Democrats, and I'm switching Democrats to the Republican Party by the thousands. And well, and what I know you've been part of a Democratic leadership council that's trying to move your party a little bit more to the right, and what I would love to do tonight is offer you membership in the Republican Party. We love you, you're a great guy. And I think you'd be a wonderful addition to our party.
Let me say this, that's not the first offer like that I've had.
Sooner or later you'll accept
it. It's difficult one to turn down, even, but maybe it's before the biggest offer.
Bob, I'm a former Democrat, you. Just like President Reagan. He is a Democrat who turned Republican. I'm a Democrat who turned Republican because I just couldn't buy the platform they put together out in San Francisco in 84. And I think the Republican Party more closely mirrors the hopes and the dreams and the aspirations of the vast majority of the American people. I think we're going to win in 88 the presidency, we're going to win the House of Representatives and the United States Senate. That's my goal, to broaden the party, not to shrink it.
Governor DuPont?
Well, Bill, I want to leave that answer and come back to George's comment on the INF Treaty, because I think it illustrates a concern that a lot of people have in this country about George's candidacy. George Bush heroically followed America into war, and he skillfully followed Richard Nixon into China, and he somewhat less enthusiastically followed Ronald Reagan into the modern economics of tax cuts and job creation. But the question is, in a Bush presidency, where would he lead America? So far, we haven't seen any vision, any principles, any policies. We really haven't had it spelled out very successfully. Our campaign, the INF Treaty is a good example of that. We're waiting for details and we're hearing generalities. And I think the question is we ought to hear some more specifics.
Pierre, my turn. Pierre, let me help you on some of this. One, I think it's a nutty idea to fool around with the Social Security system and run the risk of the people that have been saving all their lives. We made this Social Security Trust Fund solvent, and it's solvent. So that's not, it may be a new idea, but it's a dumb one. On the question of the INF treaty, I told you all these European leaders are for it. I'm for it, the president's for it, the Joint Chiefs are for it, and I don't see why you can't say, hey, if it's verifiable, it's a good idea to get rid of 1,600 warheads from the Soviet Union for 400 of ours, and then go on and do what I've said, work on conventional forces, work on chemical weapons. I put the treaty on the table in Geneva to ban chemical weapons. It's fine when you're outside, carping, criticizing a president, and it's different. I found out it's very different when you're in there having to make the tough calls.
George.
General Haig, you may address either the point raised by Ms. Robertson or the points that we've just heard discussed.
I'd like to just add a word about George's comment. You know, I've just come back from Europe as well, George, and believe me.
Talk to Margaret Thatcher? Did you talk to Helmut Kohl?
Oh. I did. I spoke to Margaret Thatcher directly, and I've spoken to...
And she's against the INF Treaty?
Not in the context. Not in the context of your question. Let me tell you, Europe is unnerved about this agreement, and the arm twisting that was applied from Washington to the European leaders is unprecedented in my memory.
Al, you supported it in the spring of 1982. I have a speech you gave on it.
I think you'll recall I fought it like the bloody death at the cabinet table. And I never heard a wimp out of you. Not a word.
Because I am for it.
Mr. Kemp.
This question is absolutely central to the future of our party.
Which one?
The question you asked. I guess I'm the only one that remembered the original question you asked Pat Robertson. But I think the Republican Party ought to thank Pat Robertson for bringing in evangelical Christians and Democrats and helping to broaden the base. That really is, Bill, what we ought to be talking about. How do we win in 88? I want to say, as a conservative, that I believe that our party not only must appeal to evangelical Christian, but ethnic Catholic, to the Jewish community, to young people, to senior citizen. And frankly, Pete, your idea of abolishing Social Security, and frankly, Pat Robertson.
Nobody's for abolishing Social Security, Jack. It's for giving a market alternative to it.
The issue is not Social Security or expanding private retirement accounts. We need both. But clearly, how can we appeal to Black, to Hispanic, to Asian Pacific, to young people and old, and we can win the House, win the Congress, and bring in the type of moral values that the American people want in this
country.
Listen
to the man here.
Senator Dole.
Well, I came here tonight to be nice and polite, but it just couldn't be, you know. This debate's starting to liven up a little. I thought I was going to die on the vine, but in any event...
What do you say?
I'm
starting to liven up a bit.
These are all nice fellows. I know I can get, you know, they're all, I know them all, and they all made mistakes. So did I, but we're not here to talk about our mistakes. I want to commend Pat Robertson. I want to build the Republican Party. I want to be a majority party in America for the right reasons. The people care about their jobs. They care about no taxes. They care about their country. They want us to make a difference. And if Pat Robertson can deliver some people to the Dole campaign a little later on, I'd appreciate it very much.
As splendid a majority leader as you might consider serving as vice president, but in any event, you'd be wonderful with the Congress.
You know, I just started to say, Pat, that these fellows are going to keep commending you. They're going to commend you into that nomination.
That's absolutely right. We're all working together, Bob. You
right.
know?
We're all going to unite,
Governor,
right?
Governor DuPont, right. I got a question for you. The initiative of President Reagan to move away from mutual assured destruction as the primary means of effecting deterrence on over towards a space shield was pretty universally disdained here in July by the Democratic candidates. If nominated, how would you hope to get from Congress the kind of support necessary to press forward with an energetic program to develop a space shield?
Well, first, Bill, the development of the Strategic Defense Initiative is vitally important to the future security of this country. Because today, if one single Soviet missile is launched by mistake at America, all we can do is watch it land. That's not protecting our freedom. That's not defending our families. We ought to research it. We ought to build it. We ought to deploy it. We got to persuade the people of this country that it's important, because congressmen listen to their constituents. We need to have an American workforce that is educated well enough, not just to research and build and to deploy the Strategic Defense Initiative today, but to meet the new technologies of tomorrow. That means changing education in America. It means a voucher system that puts competition into the schools, that brings parents into the equation, so we upgrade American education and make it not 8th or 9th or 10th best in the world, but the best in the world. Then we can build our Strategic Defense Initiative. Then we can develop the case before the American people that building that initiative will make America safer tomorrow than it is today.
Thank you. Mr. Vice President.
Well, Bill, you ask how you'd get support from the Congress. I think on SDI, you need to have the people understand it better. What it does is put weapons at risk, not people. There's nothing in this SDI research that's going to threaten a citizen in Moscow at all. It's a defensive shield, and people call it Star Wars. It's just the opposite. It's a defensive shield. We could go ahead, Pete, and deploy the under the ABM treaty. We haven't done that, but we shouldn't. We ought to go forward as fast as we can with SDI, because in the immoral nuclear age in which we are, here is a moral answer. Put weapons at risk, not people. And once the American people understand this, I believe that the Congress will do what they often do, and that is fall into line.
General Haig.
Of course, it's essential that we not turn over a monopoly in outer space to the Soviet Union. It's been busy in outer space for the last 20 years. But I question whether or not nuclear deterrence is truly immoral. We've had 50 years of peace based essentially on nuclear deterrence. And when I hear these pie-in-the-sky enunciations from the White House, a world without nuclear weapons, then I remind myself we had 50 million people killed in World War II without nuclear weapons, and we maintain nuclear weapons not just to prevail in the event of a conflict, but to prevent the outbreak of conflict in the first instance. And that's what we better remember.
Mr. Kemp.
You know, nothing separates the two parties more clearly on foreign policy than this issue of strategic defense. I offered an amendment on the floor of the House to move towards early deployment of strategic defense, And one of the chairmen of the House Armed Services Committee got up and said, the best defense for America is no defense of America. The Democratic Party believes in cutting defense. They believe in pulling out of the Persian Gulf. They won't even pay the price of freedom in this hemisphere. They're anti-SDI. I disagree with Pete and George Bush. The American people are way ahead of Congress on this issue. They want this country defended. And I believe if our party offers the American people a referendum on defending them with strategic defense and sharing anti-tactical ballistic missile defense with both Asia, Europe, and Israel, I think the Republican Party would not only have a great issue, it would move towards a peaceful solution of this offensive arms race.
Senator Dole.
Well, I want to indicate that I'm a strong supporter of SDI, and I think we're making progress. It's going to be a phased deployment. We're going to continue testing. We're going to continue research. We know that the Russians are spending millions or maybe billions of dollars on the same thing. In fact, we get recent reports that they may be catching up or whatever. So we have an obligation to do that. I don't think there's any question about it. What we've got to worry about are some in the other party who are trying to restrict the interpretation of the ABM so much and so tight that it's going to hamper research, development, and eventual deployment. So it seems to me that we ought to make certain that we're not giving something away in the Congress that we ought to get from Mr. Gorbachev. Ronald Reagan shouldn't have to negotiate with the liberal Democrats one day and Gorbachev the next.
I don't think there's any question, but SDI is what's brought Gorbachev to the negotiating table. We have had breakthroughs in science and technology, which are moving ahead of him, and I see no reason why the United States should continually lag behind the Soviets somehow to give them a comfort level. I think that's nonsense. I think we should deploy SDI in a phased fashion, as Bob said. But I listened to some of the Democrats on your previous debate, and they were throwing numbers around like $1 trillion and $2 trillion. I don't think it's anything near that. I think maybe $20 billion a year or something like that for 10 years. Mm-hmm. It's a very reasonable, inexpensive program, but it is only one part of our arsenal. It's not the end. It's an umbrella over the stadium, in a sense, but that's all it does. But it's a very effective way of protecting our civilian populations, and we should use it.
Thank you. The next segment of the program replaces what we tried last July with the Democrats. Some of you will remember that each candidate was filmed on the campaign trail telling his listeners a funny story. Few of you will remember those funny stories. Asked what he would like to be if he weren't in politics, Senator Dole recently told an interviewer he would either practice law or sit in Johnny Carson's chair. Well, in that role, he would not come up with very much Democratic competition. So this time around, the producer, Mr. Warren Stivell, elected, instead of filming six funny stories, to reach into his archives and reproduce a snippet featuring the candidates as they have appeared on Firing Line in earlier productions than this one. The design was merely to give us a stylistic view of them pleading their cases, making their points in other times and other circumstances. I introduce first Vice President Bush. We see him in 1974 as chairman of the Republican Party, defending President Nixon during the Watergate crisis, a week or two before the smoking gun was uncovered. We see here the advocate in action, the genuine loyalty, a trace maybe of buoyant fatalism.
I remember a press conference a year ago. I was speaking to the Republican governors, and I came out of it, and it's like calling central casting, saying, send over an ugly press conference scene. Mm-hmm. I was kind of shoved back into a little room, lights, these felt-covered things, goosing me from the back, pushing me in the front, saying, now what are you going to say? You're saying the party didn't hurt. Now what are you going to say? Two cabinet officers indicted. I remained beautifully calm, and I said, you would have been proud of me. I'd have said, well, indictment does not mean conviction. Yeah, but it proves, you know, and they were all made up. And from that moment on, paper after paper, homing and, you know, now you got to be, I got to be careful that I don't paint with too broad a brush, but there has been a cumulative almost denouncement of say, Maury Stans. Mm-hmm. And it got into the consciousness of people. And only when that jury unanimously acquitted him was did people wake up and say, my God, you know, all along I thought this guy had done something wrong.
Well, Jack Kemp was, as he always has been, pre-partu, in-partu, and post-partum, the optimist. It hasn't ever been charged about him that he has changed his manner now that he is running for president. He was, in 1979, asking that people share his enthusiasm for capitalism.
I think the American people are willing and recognize that we need to get back to that type of a faith in ourselves, our experience, our experiment, our ideas, and that they are the wave of the future. And I go back
I think it's interesting to hear you say this, but I don't think it's true.
Well, I really do, because I think that an ideological offense, people who are not ashamed of capitalism, who are not apologetic for free enterprise, who are not ashamed and do not retreat at the first attack, I really believe that is what the world needs. Because if you look at the third world, look at the LDC world, look at much of the world that's in poverty and huge debt and is looking for the type of leadership to which Richard alluded, seems to me that they're waiting for an America to come along and assert itself on behalf of those principles and ideas that built the greatest republic on the face of the earth.
Bob Dole in 1979 is bemoaning the tendency of some voters to vote on the basis of single resentments. He expresses himself as ever with wit, some of which hurt some people, but he thinks they can take it even as he has taken a great deal.
I have a different view than you have on the Panama Canal, and I don't quarrel with your view, and you probably
I don't mind
won't
you
quarrel
do.
With mine, but that's... It could be. I think, you know, in my view, the Republican convention will be made up primarily of conservative Republicans. They'll probably have a little list in their pocket. They'll have Bob Dole supported McGovern on food stamps. Howard Baker voted for the Panama Canal. You know, they'll have a little, and maybe John Conley was for price controls. And I assume they'll make book on all of us, so I would guess it might
George be. George Bush was for Nixon.
George Bush was for Nixon.
Pat Robertson, back in 1981, was deploring the plain lack of common sense, this time of some public television stations. As always, he is proud, genially so, of his own tendency to meet obvious problems with obvious solutions.
But I also think that, that perhaps some of the stations in PBS can learn some lessons in fundraising. I was watching a movie out in Dallas about a month or so ago, and about every 10 minutes, it was a movie about some space monster or something, and every time that the space monster would do something exciting, it would cut to the studio, and we were told for about 10 minutes to give money. I think it would have been better to have shown the movie uncut and then had the 5-minute pitch on either side for the support. It would have been much more joyfully given, I believe, by the viewers.
Thank you, Dr. Robertson.
That's my own comment. Thank you very much.
Al Haig in 1984 looks populism in the face and says that isn't the way they taught me to exercise leadership in West Point. He deplores political opportunism and does so with a soldier's gravitas.
Are you willing to name names?
Makers.
Are you willing to name names?
Why, sure, the triumvirate, mm-hmm. Which is now a duo, mm-hmm. Baker and Deaver. Mm-hmm. Now, these people get up every morning, put their finger to the wind to see what will make their leader popular. Mm-hmm. And then rush in to urge him to pursue such policy. Mm-hmm. That kind of populism is devoid of principle and philosophic root. Mm-hmm. So you can't complain on one day that it's too liberal and the next day it's too conservative. It's devoid of that, and on any occasion, it can go to the extreme of either end of the philosophic principles we are talking about. It enables a president one day, as you say, to insist that it's in the vital permanent interest of the American people to maintain our marine presence in West Beirut, and a week later to ignominiously withdraw. Mm-hmm. Now, it's always been my view that populism is not only bad substance, but it's bad politics, yeah. too. Mm-hmm. Because the American people are too smart to be influenced by the perceived pandering of their leaders to their daily whims, but rather they are influenced by the success quotient of a president. And in foreign policy, I would say the success quotient leaves something to be desired.
Pete DuPont, early this year, explains why, as an outsider, he tends to look for contradictions that voters have tolerated. Why is it because they don't understand. He shows himself the teacher, willing and anxious to teach and to lead. He just doesn't understand why the American people don't get mad at the fact that they're paying five times the world price for sugar.
Exactly so.
The answer is they don't know, most of them.
And I did an interview with a Japanese journalist the other day, and he said something about American markets. And I said, look, before we talk about greater Japanese access to American markets, why don't we talk about why the Japanese consumer is paying 10 times the world price for rice. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm not going to write about that. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, I'm sure you're not, but I said, that would mean something to your people, and it would mean something to our rice exporters, and therein perhaps lies better trade for both of us.
Yeah, there's no question we are all sinners.
Speaking of sinners, Bob, do you have any comment?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I do. I was sitting here just listening and thinking about what I might comment. I knew you were going to call on me. And, you know, it occurred to me that these fellows, you and these fellows, I might add, trying to be serious, were a hell of a lot funnier than the Democrats were, and they were trying to be funny. If this is serious, you've got something on your hands. I also want to say that the reason I'm a little tired tonight is I too have, like many of your candidates, have just returned from a trip to Europe. I just got in yesterday, and I'm sorry to be embarrassed to say I didn't see a single leader.
Bob, a lot of those leaders come to my office. Maybe I give you a ring.
Right. Well, I didn't see a single leader. Helen and I ate, and we drank, and we laughed together, and it didn't seem to hurt the country a bit. We had an awful good time.
Very competitive in that field.
Yeah, and I would also say, that, speaking of comments, on that first section, the film you had, I was interested that those candidates of yours, Bill, who were born poor, sure stressed how poor they were, but none of your rich ones stressed how rich they were. And now, if we Democrats could find a rich candidate, we'd be bragging about him all over the country.
May I have a show of hands among the candidates? Which of you is wealthier than FDR, Jack Kennedy, and LBJ?
I'd say two things. Number one, you got some candidates that are very shy. And number two, I'm sorry, offended you didn't include me in that list.
Now, this next, thank you, Bob. I'm sorry, did I interrupt you?
Wait, yeah, you sure did.
Oh, okay. Right.
And my final comment is this, that I was amazed at what a quick study these fellows really are. That in my first question, when I asked for if they could find anything at all that they would do differently, in the Reagan administration, I never saw a group of fellows that were totally unable to find anything. And within a few minutes, if you notice that debate that went on here, hell, they were up to their ears in things they would do differently in this administration and from each other. That finishes my comment.
No comment, Bob. Thank you. Now, this next segment we had to excise last July for lack of time. I'm going to select individual candidates in order: Mr. Robertson, Governor DuPont, and General Haig. And I'm going to ask them to give us the reasons why other candidates here, who will be designated by Mr. Strauss, would do less well as nominees or as president than they would do. And may I remind you all that we're all here, and you're here, because each of you thinks yourself better qualified than the competition to be our next president. In order to think well of yourself, it is necessary, whether you like it or not, to think less well of the competition. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all? So, Mr. Robertson, would you kindly talk to us about, and Bob, the selection as stipulated by the producer is who?
Yes, I want to make it clear that this I'm not Vanna White. This has been stipulated. This has been stipulated by the producer, who I point to. First, I think it was Mr. Robertson, and I'm supposed to point to Vice President Bush, is that correct?
If that's what you were told.
Yes.
All right. Fair enough. Well, we've been talking about education, George, and first of all, I want to tell you that I have founded a university. It's a graduate level, fully accredited university that has a master's program in education. Secondly, I have gone into the inner cities of America, Houston, Los Angeles, Chicago, Detroit, Brooklyn, Philadelphia, Atlanta, Birmingham, Memphis, etc.
Is it your point that he hasn't founded any universities?
No, he hasn't founded one. That's the first. But he's talking about education is going to be the platform on which he's going to run. I'm just talking about my qualifications as an educator. But we have trained 123,000 young people and adults how to read and write in the last 3 years without taking one nickel of federal money. I have come up with solutions in the private sector for relief. We last year helped about 5.5 million poor people. I have come up with solutions in certain parts of the world that did not involve government intervention. But beyond that, I think we have a serious moral crisis in America.
You're supposed to be saying where Mr. Bush disagrees with you.
You said, why would I be better at being president than you, right? Isn't that what you said?
Yeah, well, why he's less qualified than you to carry out the program.
Is there any time limit?
3.5 minutes.
We'll
3.5 minutes.
I think we'll let the vice president comment on what's happening.
You asked me to say 3.5 minutes, and I'm just giving some of the... that I'm one who makes solutions in the private sector.
We didn't say 3.5 minutes. We don't have that kind of time.
You didn't give me the... How much time do I have?
I told you this segment of the show wasn't going to work, you know, and we discussed it earlier. And that's no gag, you can believe me.
You're doing your best to justify that prophecy.
That's right.
Open-ended?
Yeah. We want to know why it is that people shouldn't vote for Mr. Bush, given his experience, but should vote for you.
Well, I don't want to talk badly about him. I want to talk positively about me.
Yeah, but that violates the rules. Let's see if Mr. DuPont is willing to...
Before you leave me, I want to say that I think George Bush is the most as fine a vice president as we have had in this century, and I would love to have him be a vice president with me, no question about it.
I've got two. Any of these men would be magnificent, but perhaps I didn't get a chance to answer. Pete, can go ahead.
I haven't heard the question yet, Ben.
Governor DuPont, we want to hear from you why you would do better as a candidate and as a president than Mr. Kemp.
You got to get the meter running down there.
It's open. How much time?
Well, Jack and I went to the Congress together. He served there since, and I was there for some years, and then had 8 years leading the government of the state. But I would say the fundamental difference between Jack and I is that our campaign is about some fundamental changes that need to be made in America that I don't believe Jack would make. The phasing out of farm subsidies, a $26 billion a year mistake that results in higher food prices and a lot of money spent by taxpayers. A voucher system in education to allow parents to choose which school their children go to bring some competition into the school.
You want to comment on
that? The strengthening of Social Security so that the baby boom generation won't be left high and dry. There are three fundamentals of our campaign for the presidency that I know Jack disagrees with.
You're looking at me all the time.
Yeah, but the camera's behind you.
That's Kemp over here. This is
you're
Kemp.
Not Jack. I'm sorry. Your views are often so similar it's hard to tell.
Very conservative. Right.
I resent that.
Yeah. Jack, I
do want to answer, and I want to applaud Pete DuPont for opening up the discussion and this debate as he has around the country on some of those issues that absolutely are essential to the future of the country and the economy and foreign policy. And I applaud you for it. But frankly, Pete, to take Social Security as an issue in 1988 and tell 40 million senior citizens or more that the system is going broke, that we're going to have to double the tax on young people, is an absolute falsity, and I don't think it's the type of a campaign that is either going to lead to your victory or to victory for the Republican Party. The Social Security system is not broke. It is not in a deficit, it's in a surplus. The greatest answer to Social Security was not raising taxes, with all due respect to Bob Dole, who believes in that.
I'm voting against the relief package that you voted against.
The answer to Social Security was keeping inflation down and getting the economy recovering. A minute ago, you abolished the farm subsidy program, and now you talk about phasing it down. Frankly, Pete, we don't know exactly which libertarian or market-oriented solution you're going to come up with next. The answer to this country's economy is low interest rates, stable money, low taxes, free enterprise zones, privatization of housing, and moving this world economy towards a more liberal and open trading system. And I take a backseat to no one, including you, in offering positive and progressive conservative ideas for the future of American free enterprise.
Well said. Do I get the answer back again? I guess not.
General Haga, I have down here to ask you why you think you ought to be president when there is the alternative of sending Mr. Dole to the White House.
Well, first, there's one thing that's very clear here tonight.
Tell that joke, Al, about Haig and Haig.
I'm going to do that.
That's good.
The first thing that's very clear here tonight, and I'm very grateful for it as a Republican, it's very evident that there isn't a single announced Democratic candidate who could tie the bootstraps of any one of our Republican candidates. Now, I'll also have to say this, and if it fits you, Pete, or it fits you, George, or perhaps even you, Bob, I made a bet with my wife coming over here tonight that no single political cliche would be left at peace tonight.
You win.
And gentlemen, you won my bet for me. That's for sure. But I think as you look at it.
Including your line about the no Democrat could tie the boots.
That's right.
That's another good cliche.
Well, I've used it before.
Senator Biden invented it.
But I don't want Bob. I don't want Bob to go unscathed, and I've been traveling around the country telling the American people, beware of Dole and Dole. It's only watered down pineapple juice. Haig and Haig is the real McCoy.
Well, my friend Bob Strauss has said that he has a philosophical question that he wants to put to you gentlemen. So in the few minutes we have before the summation, let's see what you have on your mind, Bob.
Well, I didn't know I was going to get asked that question, so I'm not sure I have anything on my mind. But let me see if I can tackle it.
Very hard, did you?
No, let me see if I can ask a question that would be of interest to the audience, listening audience. The last two presidents, one a Democrat and one a Republican, particularly the Republican, have been elected to office running against the government, running against Washington, running against the government of our country. Ronald Reagan tells us that government is not any part of the answer, it's all of the problem. I don't happen to agree with that. I think government has many faults. But I'm one who doesn't think we need to restructure this government to make it work. I don't think we need to prank with it. I think what we need to do is figure out, instead of telling people what's wrong with government, we need to figure out how we get better people, first elected and also appointed to public office. And I'd be wondering if how you fellows feel about that, and if you, once in office, think you'd be apt to continue to serve while denouncing the government that you're serving.
Gentlemen, you have 45 seconds each to answer Mr. Strauss's question. Mr. Kemp.
I think it was Walter Lippmann who one time said that it's true that government is best which governs least. Then he went on to say it's equally true that government is best which does the most for people, and the purpose of leadership is to provide the type of balance between the role of government in our lives and the role of the free and private individuals and the private markets and the free enterprise system. That really is a careful balance. And I think Ronald Reagan was right when he said that the government has become not just the umpire or the official or the referee that levels the playing field so that every man and woman can compete and help those who are non-competitive to become competitive when he ran in 1980. It may be in 88 that we need the government to remove those barriers that stand in the way of this country and this economy achieving full employment for all Americans without inflation, that can boost our trade opportunities by helping other countries develop their economies, and of course help defend this country, which is an obligation constitutionally for each and every one of us. So I think people would be inspired to run for office on that type of a platform.
Senator.
Well, I happen to believe the government affects everyone in this audience, and everyone who may be viewing this debate tonight. Some of it may not like, but one way or the other, the government affects us, and many people are sustained by the government. So the government's here to stay. It's not going to go away. We're going to try to tighten it up. There are things we want to do as far as deregulation, less government interference, us don't change the tax rates. Everybody get on record for that tonight. And let's let government do what it should do, provide services for the people. I would also say in Bob Strauss's question that in 76 and 80 and 84, the American people wanted an outsider. I think in 1988, the American people are looking for an insider, somebody who knows the Congress, can work with Congress, and get things done. And my time is up.
Robertson.
I'm Jeffersonian enough, Bob, to think that that government governs best, it governs least. I think the people want Walter Limpen, in any event, I believe that the people of America want lean and efficient government, and we've got to redefine the role and the scope of government because it's overspending and it's bloated and it's inefficient. I'm in a business background myself, and if I had a board of directors that had lost $200 billion a year, I assure you we would fire them, not give them a raise.
Governor DuPont.
I think the reason, Bob, that so many of us in the conservative majority in America are running against government and worried about government is that the government in Washington doesn't seem to reflect our values. We believe in the importance of the individual as compared to the government. We believe in the traditional American family. We believe in the moral superiority of representative democracy over Soviet communism. We believe that the job of government is to push opportunity into people's kitchens, to empower them to participate in that great magic of the American marketplace. We believe that a strong America will be a free America, and we don't apologize for our strength. And so often, the government in Washington seems to take a different view, and that's why those of us in the conservative majority are upset about that government.
Well, those of you in the conservative majority, I would point out, have had 7 years in government, seven controlling the presidency.
We didn't have Congress.
Six of those years you controlled the Senate, and if you couldn't put the kind of values in there in that time, how long do you think it would take? I'm a patient man.
Bob, let me give you an example. Yeah. Those of us in the conservative majority watched Robert Bork be savaged by the Senate Judiciary Committee, and that's not in line with our values. I like that.
Mr. Vice President.
Let me get back to the question. I'm not anti-government. When I was at the CIA, I ran into some of the finest, most public-spirited people I've ever served with. Similarly, when I was in doing things in foreign affairs. And so I'm not one who tears down those who have elected to serve their country. Certainly, that's true of the military. I have great respect for Al and others who served the military. Great respect, and thank heavens we've restored kind of the patriotic spirit about that kind of service. But really, I think what it boils down to is leadership. Leadership in the White House and leadership in the United States Congress. Don't blame those that make a lifetime of service to the government, give them the kind of leadership they need, and they'll follow and get the job done.
General Haig, thank you.
Let me try to answer specifically your question, because I have served seven presidents, four at intimately close range. And I've concluded that the best presidents I have known knew from the outset that it took one kind of a guy to get you elected. An image maker, another kind of guy to help you govern once you are elected. And they reached out into America and brought the very quality that our country is so easily able to provide. The second part of this question I'd like to touch upon, and Pete led into it, is the reorganization of the Congress. You know, it's a one-man, one-vote anarchy today. In the early period of my experience with the presidency, you could get the leaders of the various committees in on a Monday morning of both parties, sit down, hammer out a compromise, and they would deliver. Today, the most outrageous radical in the House or the Senate is the one that gets the attention on that tube and is probably going to be voted back next year. And so our Congress, our leaders, must reinstitute discipline within that Congress as we must bring excellence in the executive branch.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, the clock is pressing. The final segment of our illuminating couple of hours with these candidates, their own statements, limited to 2 minutes, of why it is you should want to be the next president. I proceed in the order in which our guests were seated, as drawn by blind ballot by the mayor of Houston, Kathy Whitmore, which reminds me why aren't... Sorry about that. Sorry. Which reminds me, why aren't all conventions held in Houston? Our first summary then will come from Mr. Robertson.
Thank you, Bill. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my feeling that we need to restore the greatness of America through moral strength. We see Americans consuming 60% of the world's drugs. We see a family crisis with 14.6 million children with one or more single parents. We see a million girls, teenagers, pregnant every year. We see a declining school situation. And we realize that our economic strength, instead of being the world's greatest creditor, by the end of this year, we will owe $400 billion in the world economy, and we've become the world's largest debtor. Now, we can congratulate ourselves on all the wonderful things we have done, and I believe this is the greatest nation on the face of the earth, and I am proud to be an American. But I know that you feel, as I feel, that we owe something to our children and our grandchildren. We're the first generation ever to consume the patrimony of our unborn children on our wasteful excesses. And this isn't being anti-government, it's the truth. And we need to do something in America. If one out of every four workers is on drugs on the job, if we have a spread of AIDS, a virulent infection, life-threatening, one of the worst in the history of the world, it's time for action. Yes, we've been talking about leadership, but what are the practical solutions? It seems like to me the first thing we've got to do in America is get back to basics. And many of the things are not governmental solutions. We can't make through government husbands love their wives or wives love their husbands or families bring up their children as law-abiding, God-fearing citizens. That's got to be done in the private sector. But I believe an opportunity for all Americans. I believe in reaching out to every segment of our society, to the inner cities, to the blacks, to the Hispanics, to those in the South, the North, the East, and the West, that truly this nation might be one nation under God.
Senator Dole.
Well, first I want to thank you, Mr. Buckley, Mr. Strauss, and the audience, and those who may be still watching. Particularly in Iowa, New Hampshire, and the other early states. So we take... You know, I believe that Americans select their president with the best of intentions. I mean, I think they see through all the noise and everything else, and I've often felt that whether you're man or woman, young or old, black or white, brown, whatever, that you're looking for someone to be president of the United States who can make a difference. Make a difference as far as education is concerned. Make a difference as far as jobs are concerned. Make a difference as far as security, our nation, our government. And I believe I can make a difference. I believe I've made a difference. I believe I've been tested in my lifetime in many, many ways. I've failed, and I've gotten up and started over again. But making a difference is making things happen. producing, working with the Congress, working with people, making certain we reach out for more and more people and not forget those who've been left behind, those who've never found the ladder of success. It's an obligation we have. And I believe I can lead this country. I think I've demonstrated that, whether it was rescuing Social Security, passing the 85 Farm Bill, shepherding tax rate reductions through the Congress, supporting the President on foreign policy. But I want to close with just one statement. We're faced today with a crisis, a global crisis. We can make fun of the stock market. It's going to have an impact across this country. We need strong leadership. We need leadership around the world. This is a global problem. Having said that, I don't think the Congress sees the urgency yet, but I want to promise you in a Dole administration, we'll understand when emergency arises and we'll deal with it.
Thank you, Senator. Kemp.
I'd like to address my remarks to Republicans in the audience and those watching by saying that I don't think leadership is giving speeches about it. I don't think leadership is calling for it or just talking about it. Leadership is understanding what needs to be done and then doing it. Frankly, I am convinced that we're entering an age in which we have some stark choices. But there are no problems in this country that we can't resolve working together. There really are no limits to the future of this country that we can't see a better life for each and every American, not only here, but from the inner city to the rural areas of America, by not only working together, but recognizing those ideas that made this country great. We need to move America and the world away from a doctrine of relying on offensive nuclear weapons of mass destruction as a deterrent to war, to relying on a strategic defense. I think our party ought to offer that to the American people in 1988. I plan to offer that. I believe we should build it. I don't think we should equivocate. I think this is a choice in the Republican Party between the old guard who want to test it forever, and then those of us who want to move on. With all due respect to the Vice President and to Bob Dole, they're against early deployment. I believe we ought to build it. John F. Kennedy didn't research and test going to the moon. He told America that we were going to go to the moon. Number two, we've got to decide what kind of an America we're going to defend. Defense of the family and our children and the inalienable rights. And finally, we must move this economy to full employment without inflation for each and every American. So that every American can not only have a platform under which they shouldn't be allowed to fall in some catastrophe, but have a ladder of opportunity upon which each and every one of them can climb to reach their dreams as Americans. The inalienable rights of people were not written by Jefferson for some people, but for all people. And not for just this country, but for all country. And I want the Republican Party to be that type of a party.
Thank you. General Haig.
Let's face it, this campaign is changing importantly. We Americans are facing a serious economic situation here at home, and we're facing the most cunning, the most sophisticated Soviet leader since Lenin. This means that we cannot conduct politics as usual and pick our candidate based on his pleasantness before the cameras, his skill at raising money, perhaps his ability to collect political IOUs from the party. America does not want business as usual, not more of the same. We are facing tough problems, and we need a tough leader. To me, toughness is strength, it is skill, and it is judgment. Strength to recognize that the loneliness of decision-making in the Oval Office is unique. Strength to recognize that a president must be guided not by his polls, but by his conscience. And the strength to know that the true power of the presidency is the trust of the American people. Skill to bring our deficit down, to close our trade gap, to improve the quality of American education, to deal with the problems of drugs, and to achieve social justice in a practical and meaningful way for all Americans. Judgment to know that good government in America means that we have bettered the life of all Americans. That's why I am asking for your support.
Thank you, Donald. Mr. Vice President.
With respect, I don't think it's theory. I think people are looking for experience. In mine, combat, building a business, intelligence business, foreign affairs, heading our party at a difficult time, and vice president for 7 years. And I've seen what it's like in crisis, when a president was shot, a ship was fired on, or an airliner shot down, or when we had to move against terrorists, or indeed move to free a tiny little Caribbean country from Marxist domination. My view is that when somebody goes into that booth to vote and pull that lever, he's not looking for economic theory or legislative genius or who looks best on television. He's looking to answer this question: who has the values we believe in, the experience that we trust, and the steadiness and the integrity to get the job done? As president, I try to keep us out of a crisis. That's not the way it works. They're there. And my belief then is that you need somebody in that hot seat with a cool hand on the stick. I've been co-pilot for 7 years, and I know how to land a plane in a storm. I've been there. Thank you very much.
Governor DuPont.
Well, Americans need to know the principles and the policies of someone who would be their president. I believe in the potential of the individual. That's why we should say to the able-bodied on welfare, if you want to check, you have to work. I believe in protecting the potential of the next generation of Americans. That's why we should say to our teenagers, if you want to drive, you have to pass a driving test and a drug test. I understand that the family is fundamental to America. That's why I favor a voucher system in education so parents can choose their children's school, and parents, not teachers or administrators, can be the ones who shape the lives of our young children. I understand how fragile freedom can be in a democracy. George Bush said earlier tonight that peace was his most important priority. George is a genuine war hero. And surely he's not forgotten what he was so brave for. World War II was not about peace. It was about freedom. So is SDI about freedom. So is joining in common cause with freedom fighters around the world. So is rejecting bad deals and arms control with the Soviet Union. I believe in the moral importance of strength in America, because our strength is our freedom. But America is at risk not only from aggressive enemies abroad. A government at home that does not understand its limits can be a threat to our liberty, too. That's why I'm for ending that $26 billion in wasted agricultural subsidies, because that's a threat to our economic freedom. That's why I spoke earlier of a financial security system to supplement Social Security, because the Social Security system is not going to be strong enough to protect the retirement of a whole generation of Americans tomorrow, unless we make some changes in it today. Clear principles, sound policies, and common sense. That's what the presidency of the United States is about.
Thank you, Governor. Mr. Strauss has requested the floor. Bob.
Thank you, Bill. Let me do my wind-up on this show by reminding you, each of you, that I was here in July when Firing Line and Bill Buckley sponsored a debate very similar to this for the Democratic Party. And it was a good evening and a good debate, and I suspect it will help us, I hope, choose a good candidate. And I think tonight has been a splendid evening, Bill, and it too has been we've had a spirited debate, and I think it will help the Republican Party select a good candidate. And that's really what it's all about. Some of us are Democrats and some of us are Republicans. And sometimes we're in and sometimes, like me, we're out. But it isn't really as important as whether we're Democrats or whether we're Republicans. What's important is that this great process go on. It goes on every 4 years, and we're getting into it now. And I couldn't be happier to have been a part of this show this evening. I enjoyed it equally as much as I did the show a few months ago, and I wish each of you Godspeed and a good campaign. And to you again, Bill, thanks for hosting a first-rate show for both parties.
Thank you so much, Bob. Bob, I want to apologize.
It's an apology, go ahead.
Bound transcript of this special, send $5 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Funding for this program was made possible by major grants from the American General Corporation, an insurance-based, diversified financial company with more than $24 billion of assets. NCR, Innovative Computer Technology. It can be expected from NCR. Oppenheimer Funds Management, the Oppenheimer family of mutual funds. PPG Industries, a world leader in glass, chemicals, instruments, and coatings technology. And additional support from these friends of Firing Line: the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Mobil Corporation, and Essex Chemical.